Start at verse number one. He says in 2 Kings 1, 8 and 1, now Elijah has said to the woman whose son he had restored to life, he said, arise and go with your household and sojourn wherever you can. For the Lord has called for a famine, and moreover, it will come upon the land for 7 years. Now, because of the connection, the prophetic connection that this woman had with the prophet, there was three things that manifested in the relationship and for her. One, he said to her, I want you to go, you and your household, to a land, and I want you to sojourn there, man. I want you to stay there because the Lord has brought a famine upon this land for 7 years. So because of her prophetic connection with the prophetic, the first thing the prophetic anointing did, it gave her some instructions. Mm-hmm. And so as she began to heed to the instructions, mm-hmm. as you notice in this chapter, she didn't question the instructions. Mm-hmm. Because before, when the prophet came to her and said, what can I do to bless you? Mm-hmm. He began to speak and said, and he told her that he was going to bless her with a child. Mm-hmm. She spoke back, mm-hmm. what do I have to do with thee? Don't lie to me. Mm-hmm. In other words, don't lie to me, prophet. Mm-hmm. But because of the prophetic connection and the relationship that she had with the prophet over the years, when he came to her and gave her some specific instructions, he said, look, I want you to get your household. And isn't it amazing that she went to the prophet? The prophet came to her and gave instructions, but her husband said nothing. Because he was truly the man of the house. But she was the one that had the prophetic connection. And it was because of her connection. Why was it because of her connection? Because she was the one that perceived that he was a man of God. So she was the one that had the sensitivity in the spirit, where the spirit was dealing with her in such a way where she was sensitive to the anointing that was on his life. So she was the one that perceived that he was a man of God. So because she perceived that he was a man of God, she went out of her way to make a way for him. And because she went out of her way to make a way for him, it connected her in the spirit. Yeah. So when he gave her the instructions and told her, look, I want you to go to a certain place. He didn't tell her where. He just said, go to a certain place, and I want you to stay there for 7 years. So he's telling her, I'm giving you the time to leave, and I'm giving you the time to return. Right. Yes, and a lot of times when it comes to decision making in our life, we don't know what to do, how to do it, when to do it, or how to go about doing it. We don't even know who to go to ask for specific instructions, directions. So here, because of her relationship with the prophet, he gave her some specific instructions. And those instructions led her to give her some direction. Mm-hmm. And she followed the direction, meaning she followed the mouth of God. And then if you look on down, go to verse number 2, he says, so the woman arose, mm-hmm. and did as the man of God said. So she followed the instructions. See, a lot of times we miss out on the plan of God, the purpose of God, and even the timing of God, because we don't follow the instructions of God. See, that's what we have to come to as a body, because we believe that our tears move God, but your tears don't move God. Whenever there's a question on your heart concerning what you need from God, and you go to him, God is always going to answer your question with the question, and he's going to give you to follow some form of direction, meaning you don't get nothing from nothing. So you're going to have to get some form of direction from him. So he told her, he said, look, she arose and she went and did as the man of God said, her and her household. No one questioned. Are you sure that a phantom is going to come? Wait a minute, you was the same one that rose my sons from the dead. How come you can't stop this phantom from coming now in my life? Because if you was able to raise the dead, surely you can speak now to the heavens. Did not you, weren't you the same Elijah that spoke to the heavens and said that it wasn't going to rain for 3 years? So if you were the same Elijah that spoke to the heavens and said that it wasn't going to rain for 3 years, how can you not withhold this phantom that's coming in the land for 7? Aren't you the one that literally that God speaks through, that God used, that have a relationship with God? So why do I have to go through this for 7 years? Why do I have to be inconvenienced for 7 years? We question what we want from God. We question the instructions that God give us. And we question the timing of God. But whenever we have to go through something difficult, we always want the easy way out.
That's right.
But God, I believe God sends the phantoms in the land so the prophets can be raised.
Right.
So God allows the phantoms to come forth to see who going to follow the instructions. Because a lot of us look for God to be this masculine, to be something so spiritual and so deep that you can't see. But otherwise, when you meet me, you meet God. When you come to the place where you realize you meet me, you meet God. That's God that's speaking to you. Are you going to be able to follow the instructions that God gave you when it's wrapped in a package that you don't recognize? So a lot of times, because we look at the package and we don't hear God, we don't follow the instructions. And that's who calls us to miss out on our prophetic because he's always going to give us some instructions. He's always going to cause you to go out of something you don't want to do. It's going to be difficult. It's going to be an inconvenience for you. It's going to cause you to have to uproot, to let go, or to disconnect from something when it comes to giving you instructions.
That's right.
So this woman, because of her prophetic connection, she ain't even questioned him no more. She went and got that son that he raised from the dead. She went and got that husband that was real old. And she packed up everything she needed to pack up. And then went on down the road to where they had to go.
Hallelujah.
So then he says in verse number 3, at the end of 7 years, the woman returned from the land of the Philistines. And she went to appeal to the king for her house and her land. That's one thing that I like about this woman. See, that's one thing about women. We have to understand there's a boldness in us.
Oh, right.
And when you come to the place where you have a relationship with God, she had a relationship with the mind of God. And because she had a relationship with the mind of God, there was such a boldness in her. She said, you know what? Let me go talk to this king for myself. Because I've been away from my property and from my land for 7 years. And there's been a phantom that has gone through this land. And because there's been a phantom that's gone through this land, now let me go to who's in charge. Who's in charge right now? Who's running things right now? Even though I have a prophetic relationship, that prophetic relationship will give you a boldness when you have gone through some things, when you have walked through some things, when you have seen the hand of God like she saw the hand of God, because she saw the hand of God raise her dead son from the dead. So if you can raise my son, you can surely
do this.
So she went to the king.
Jesus.
And when she went to the king, look at verse number 4. It says the king was talking with Gehazi. Come on here now. You know the story of Gehazi. Gehazi was a lying, unclean spirit. Because Gehazi was the one that used to serve the prophet. Gehazi was the one that used to serve the prophet. And because he used to serve the prophet, he saw the gifts and he saw the miracles and he saw the hand of God that operated through the prophet. So he was amazed at all the flame that came with the prophetic anointing. And so he saw the riches that came with it. And so he said, well, if my master is not going to take these gifts, surely I'm not going to let them go to waste. So if you don't want to take what name to go give you, I'll go ahead ahead and partake of your fruit for you. So Gehazi was bold and bad enough to witness the anointing that Elijah operated in, and still had the audacity to stand before the man of God, before the power of God, and lie to the prophet.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did.
That's when you take your prophetic relationships for granted. When you take your prophetic relationships to such a place where you have seen the power of God operate in your life and around you, and then you lie because you don't believe. So then, Gehazi was standing up there talking to the king. Now, did you not read the story? Did Gehazi not receive leprosy because he stood before the king because he lied to the prophet? See, that's one thing about the prophetic anointing that we don't realize in this day. A prophet can speak a blessing in your life, and they can also put one on that you don't want.
You better say that again.
So Elijah told Gehazi, you're going to stand before me flat-footed and lie and tell me that you did not try to get these garments from Naaman. The same leprosy that was on him is now on you. So even though Gehazi was in the position where he had leprosy and he was unclean and he had a lying spirit, God still gave him grace and mercy and had him standing before the king. Because in that day, an unclean person had to go to a separate camp. They didn't have access to everybody and to everything. So because of his relationship with Elijah, God still gave him favor to stand before authority and for the king to stand there and hold a conversation with him. Because if you read the verse, the king asked him, tell me the things that Elijah did. I want you to explain them to me. I heard about the things, but I want you to tell me what he did. So Gehazi was standing before the king, telling him the things that Elijah did. And look at verse number 7. When the king asked the woman, verse number 6. And Gehazi was telling the king now how Elijah restored the dead to life. Behold, the woman whose son he had restored to life appeared to the king for her house and land. And Gehazi said, my lord, O king, this is the woman, and this is her son, whom Elijah brought back to life. See, that's another thing about that prophetic anointing and prophetic connection. It'll have you in the right place at the right time for the right season.
That's right.
For the right season. It was all of it was a setup.
Yes.
He used the lion spirit to exalt the man of God. And as he used that lion spirit to exalt the man of God, that same woman that literally had the prophetic connection was in the right place at the right time. And then he says, when the king asked the woman, she told him. So the king appointed to her. I like this. He appointed to her a certain officer. He said he appointed to her a certain officer. So that means that there are certain people in authority that you can meet that will do something for you. There's certain, he said, a certain officer saying, restore all that was hers and all the fruit of the field since the day that she left the land, even until now. So here, this prophetic connection brought this woman of God to the place where everything that she has that was stolen, that was lost, everything that was destroyed, she got it back in the twinkling of an eye, because she had a prophetic connection, and the prophetic connection had her at the right place at the right time. See, when you deal with that relationship concerning the prophetic, it causes you to be sensitive to the Spirit. And when it causes you to be sensitive to the Spirit, you learn how to hear God. Mm-hmm. And when you learn how to hear God, you learn how to move when the Spirit mm-hmm. say move. Because see, sometimes the Spirit may tell you to move, but you go into your own reasoning.
Yeah.
And when you begin to go into your own reasoning, it will cause you to move in your timing and not the Spirit's timing.
Right.
Because she could have delayed herself in her moving,
right.
and she would have missed her appointment.
That's
she would have
right.
missed the season that's that right. Gehazi was there, and she would have missed with the king, because right then the king was interested in Elijah. He wanted to know about the prophetic.
Oh, yeah.
And that's one thing about the prophetic anointing that the Holy Spirit is beginning to show me. We are in the prophets need to be in a position where they realize that you have to do some works that's going to leave a legacy.
Yes.
Somebody got to hear about your work. Somebody want to know something that the prophets have done. Who have you raised from the dead? Who life have you spoken into that you have packed that life in such a way that authority wants to hear about it? There needs to be some prophets that's able to go to the White House and speak a word of God concerning the nations and the cities to impact them in such a way when the president of the United States wake up, he don't have to go to his cabinet, but he dials up the prophet and say, give me some direction on the city in this season. But God, you as a prophetic anointing, you gotta have a voice to the heaven when you're able to impact the world.
Yes,
I have told the Holy Spirit, even though last word, I say, God, I thank you and I praise you, but forgive me because I'm tired of coming to church and just doing business.
I know what you mean.
When I come to a church, to a gathering of people, I want to see the presence of God. I need to see some type of movement of the Spirit. It's not just in the song. It's not just in somebody laying out, but the dead need to be raised. And the blind eyes need to be opened. The hearts need to be broken. People need to be delivered. How can you keep coming to this service day after day, week after week, and not see the hand of God in your life? Not see some doors open for you. Not see some strongholds broken. Something got to change. How can we call ourselves prophets? We don't demonstrate the power of God. How can you call yourself a child of God and you not demonstrate the power of God? What blood are you representing?
Come out. Come out. Out.
Mm-hmm.
Time out.
Change.
As business.
Permanent change.
As usual. You ought to get tired of being in your same sticky place.
That's true. Yeah.
You've been there so long, it carries an odor.
That's true.
You need to be tired of that stench.
Yes,
that's right.
Yes.
You need to want a new fragrance.
Amen.
And the only way we can get a new fragrance, we got to have the anointing that will usher in a new fragrance for God.
Jesus.
I say, God, show me.
Jesus.
You didn't birth us here for just this.
Yes.
We didn't come here for just this. Your suffering that you've gone through,
yes.
what you have gone without, those that have turned their back on you, those that have stabbed you in the back, those that have walked away from you, was not that for in vain?
No. Come on now.
That's right.
No.
No, that's
right.
Your labor is not in vain.
No, it's not.
What you do for God,
Amen.
That's the only thing
that's
going to last.
That's right.
That's the only thing that he is going to remember.
Right.
What you do for him.
Yeah.
Because everything else he throw it in
yeah.
a spirit.
Oh, yeah.
Called forgetfulness.
Yeah.
But what you do for him, that's what's going to last.
That's it.
It's time for us to stop just trying to do. Come to church, act like we're doing somebody a favor. You ain't doing nobody
a favor.
You ain't impressing me. Your dang show ain't impressing me. Just because we see faces, same faces. I want to see some power.
I know you
I want to see the authority. God represents more than a building.
Yes,
he stands for more than just us coming here, lifting our hands and giving him praise. You need to go to the drug house. You need to go deal with them on the street. Lift your hand and give him praise then. Or stand before some stores. Stand before some schoolhouses. Go to some of them drug houses and begin to lift your hand and give God praise. Somewhere where the blood needs to be manifested. The blood needs to be manifested. And we as the body, we keep what thinking about, God, I can't do this because my father hurt me. God, I can't move over here because my mama hurt me. God, I can't walk over here because I was molested as a child. I was taken advantage of because they robbed me. That's under the blood. So what? Get over it and move it. Go on and do what the Spirit says to do. Stop living in that old day. Because all that they do is suck your power.
Amen.
don't demonstrate no power as long as you in that day.
That's true.
I can't prosper because my mama don't love me.
Yeah.
I can't move because I don't have this relationship with this person.
Yeah.
Your mama did what she was supposed to do.
That's
she was
right.
supposed to lay on her back and pop you out.
I know
that was her job. And from that point on,
all
she
had to
do was give you to God. After that, she don't have nothing else to do with
it. Don't tell me about it, amen. That's enough right there.
That's why you gotta know what the blood stands for. The blood stands for redemption. The blood stands for power. The blood means literally it has been washed. So you need to take your mind and wash it in the blood. So your old memories can go away and they can stop hindering you.
That's very true.
Well, let me show you that scripture.
Because of the prophetic connection. Stay in 2 Kings 8. And go down to verse number go to verse number 9 for me. After the woman had got all restored to her, then it talks about some acts that Elijah did. It says, then Elijah came to Damascus, and Ben-Hadad, king of Syria, was sick, and he was the man of God. And he was told, the man of God has come here. So the king heard about Elijah. And the king said to Hazael, take a present in your hand. Come on here now. We skip over that. Say, take a present in your hand and go meet the man of God. And inquire of the Lord by him, saying, shall I recover from this disease? So here it is, this man in authority was dealing with a disease. There was a strong discomfort. Meaning he was not just dis-eased in his body, he was dis-eased in his spirit. So there was a discomfort that was with him. So he told his servant, he said, look, take a present. Don't go before this prophet empty-handed. Bring something to him because I have a need. I have a question that needs to be answered. And I know once the prophet sees my gift, he will answer my question. See, that's when the Bible says your gift will make room for you. That's the type of gift that's going to make room for you. Because when there's a question on your heart, if you know how to really bring a gift to the Lord, it's going to literally come up to him in such a way, whatever is on your heart shall be answered. So his gift made room for him. So Hazael went to meet Elijah and took a present with him of every good thing of Damascus. Every good thing. Come on here now. He didn't go get the second best. He gave him the best. Every good thing. He picked one good thing of everything that was in that land, and he brought it to the prophet. He said, 40 camels loads. And came and stood before him and said, your son Ben-Hadad, king of Syria, has sent me to you asking, shall I recover from this disease? He said, shall I recover from this disease? So, I'm asking you, are you able to see for me? Come on here now.
Yes.
And Elijah said, go and say to him, you shall certainly recover, but the Lord has shown me that he shall certainly die. In the same breath, he told him. Now from the disease, you shall recover. You shall recover from the disease because your gift made room for you. But because you're going to recover from the disease, but you still going to die. So it's something that I'm speaking to you right now. You still going to die. Now his servant told him. He didn't tell him he was going to die. He just said, you're going to recover.
Yes. Yeah, he was happy.
And Elijah said, go say to him, you shall certainly recover, but the Lord has shown me that he shall certainly die. So Elijah stared steadily at him until Hazael was so embarrassed, and the man of God wept. So Elijah kept staring at this spirit. He stood, he said, you stood before me on behalf of your king asking a question, and you present me with these gifts. So I'm letting you know your king is going to recover from his disease. But he's gonna die. Why is he going to die?
Oh, well.
And then Elijah fixed his eyes on that servant, on Hazael. He fixed his eyes on him, and he began to stare at him so long. Why was he staring at him? Because the father was giving him an image of what he was going to do. And he stared at him so long to literally, he began to see in the spirit what the works that this man was going to do. And he began to weep. Elijah began to cry. He began to break down because God was giving him a vision. So here you see that the prophets are able to see concerning your life. And even though they can speak a word concerning your life, it literally, they can put you in a position where it will override what you believe. So Elijah said,
"My Lord, my Lord."
I thought this was awesome when God showed me this. He said, Elijah, in verse 12, he said, Hazael said, "Why do you weep, my Lord?" Speaking to Elijah.
Hazael.
And he asked him, "Because I know the evil that you will do to the Israelites. You will burn their strongholds, slay their young men with the sword, dash their infants in pieces, and rip up the pregnant women." So here he was sitting up there looking at this evil spirit. He was seeing all the things that literally he was going to do literally in the land. And then Hazael said, "What? Is your servant a dog?" Meaning, you telling me I'm getting ready to do this? Is this in me? So when a prophet reveals to you who you are, you don't even know what's in your own heart until it's brought to you through the prophetic anointing. So don't take that prophetic gift for granted, because that gift is such an awesome, powerful gift. It will give you visions. It will show you insight. It will give you direction. It will turn a heart right before you, because as the prophet was staring at him and he was seeing the images of all the things that he was doing, it was turning his heart even as he was staring at him. And as his heart was being turned, he's like, "God, it was all for God's purpose. And it was all for God's glory." Okay. I ain't going to keep you long. Then he said, "Am I a dog? Because only a dog could stoop this low, that he should do this monstrous thing." And Elijah answered, "The Lord has shown me that you will be king over Syria." So when he heard that he was getting ready to take a position of authority, then Hazael departed from Elijah and came to his master. And he said to him, "Did Elijah say to you?" And he answered, "He told me you should surely recover." Come on here now. It's just like Gehazi. He stood before his king. He didn't give him all of the story. He told him that he surely will recover. But he didn't say it. But on the other voice, he said, "You shall surely die." But the next day, Hazael took the bedspread and dipped it in water and spread it on the Syrian king's face so that he died. And Hazael reigned in his stead. So everything that the prophet has seen concerning Hazael, he manifested. So in order for him to get his position, he killed the king himself. And because the prophet saw in the spirit that he had the heart of a murderer, he literally seen the evilness that was in him. So when the prophet comes to you and they begin to stand before you, and God begins to give them images and directions of where your future is and what their plans are, believe me, they can begin the prophetic anointing, because it's the mind of God can turn the heart of anyone that's standing before him. Because did not God say that I can turn the hearts of the king? But a lot of people don't want to hear that because they don't want to believe that a prophet can have that much authority. But it's not the vessel, it's the spirit. And when you get in tune with the spirit, you realize that the spirit has liberty to do what the spirit is going to do, because it's all for the glory of God.
Yes, it is.
Not only can he restore, but he can turn. He can restore what has been lost in your life. What has been stolen in your life? What do you need to get back from God? Where have you been for the last 7 years? And there's some things in your life that you know that you have given up for the kingdom of God. You know that you have walked away from. You know you have let these things go. You know that these things have literally been stolen from you. What have you walked away from? And God says now.
Okay, now.
But first.
Yes.
You got to have a prophetic connection.
That's very true.
So if you don't have one, then you don't qualify.
Amen.
I understand the blood. I understand the blood. I understand you know Jesus. I understand you asked Jesus into your heart. I understand you even spoke to the Holy Ghost and asked him to come into your heart. But according to the plan of God, you have to have a prophet in your life.
You have to. Amen.
I didn't write the book.
That's very true. No, it's true.
I don't think that I'm making it up.
Come on, prophet.
I'm trying to build myself up.
Amen.
It ain't about me. It's about the Spirit.
Yes, it is.
It's about purpose. It's about what God want to do for you.
Amen.
See, God will put us to the test. Well, he will cause us to look at an individual and have to put our faith in the God in him because they don't want to recognize the God in them. So since you don't want to recognize the God in them, he will have you stand before someone that literally that's operating in the power of God in the earth realm, because did not he say that we were all God? So literally when I meet you, I meet God. So as I meet God in you and then the God in me, as we begin to come into agreement, then the mind of God for both of us will begin to speak. But until you come in agreement knowing that you too are God in the earth realm, then you'll continue to operate in your flesh mind. And now we read about the flesh mind in the first service where you talk about the carnal mind is in your own reasoning, by your own understanding, how you try to figure things out in your own knowledge. Literally, you don't get in the Spirit and ask the Spirit for direction. Or when you come to the Spirit, meaning when you come to the prophetic, you come to the Spirit. Because as you come to the prophetic, you come into Christ. So as you come to his mind and ask his mind for direction, then it's not in your own reasoning. Because every time you try to figure something out in your own reasoning, then it deals with your own senses. And your senses are not the Spirit of God. Your senses is flesh. So you can't figure nothing out with your own senses. You got to tap into the Spirit, baby. You got to know that the Spirit is speaking. That's why you got to step out of your own understanding. That's why you literally got to lose your mind and your own reasoning about things. Because God will cause you to step out in the deep.
Yes, he will. Yes,
what thing about him? He don't do nothing for your convenience.
That's right.
You're not going to be convenient.
That's very true.
The Spirit is going to cause you to be inconvenienced. That's why you're going to lose things. That's why people are going to walk away. That's why you're going to be turned into another man. That's the only way. You can't be turned into another man being in the same connection. You got to leave something in somebody. You got to have some disconnections in your life in order for you to be turned into another man. Because as long as you're walking in that fleshly man, you ain't got no power.
Come on, prophet.
No power, no change.
No power.
That's true.
You got to be turned. You got to come to yourself. Because see, we were with him before the foundation of the world. So when we come to ourselves, we go back to our position when we was with him. And when we go back to our position when we were with him, that means we begin to think like him. We qualify to think like him. We are enabled, literally, as he thinking, so we can think.
Yes, Lord.
Because remember, he got to have you to manifest his thoughts in the earth realm.
That's right.
That's why he wants you to take him on.
That's right.
Because he needs you
yes,
to manifest his thoughts. So wake up. Let that day is the Spirit of God. Wake up.
Come on, prophet.
And come to yourself.
That's right.
Come to the real you.
The real you.
Aren't you tired of having the experience of the old you? Haven't you lived in that body long enough? Are you ready to take on a new body? Literally, are you really ready to take on an image that you haven't seen before? Are you ready to step into some places that you didn't think you qualified for?
Come on, prophet.
God knows I am. I see enough in this realm. I need to go to another realm so I can experience that. I want to know that experience.
Yes. Amen.
Glory to God.
Every day I walk around that apartment, I say, God, you're bigger than this. God, you're bigger than this. And he said, and as soon as you declare my glory,
there you go.
In that apartment, I'll put you out.
That's what he'll do.
But until you declare my glory, in that place. Because there's some people there that's believing in me. There's some people there that need some direction. There's some people there that literally I have
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. You understand me?
Somebody say,
you are
the prophet. I've been there before.
In the land. Yes. Did not I tell you, every place that the soles of your feet tread upon.
Come on
here now. I'm not just talking about for your glory. I'm talking about God.
Yes, Lord.
So every place that the soles of your feet tread upon, every soul that's reparated, that is represented in that place, that soul you are supposed to be speaking to. That soul you are supposed to give some direction. That soul I'm holding you accountable for. Because you have my mind.
Wow.
You have my mind. I'm telling you, you gotta come to a place where you come into agreement with the authority that I have given you.
Yes.
We gotta wake up, people.
Yes.
We gotta wake up. I did not ask to be a prophet.
Come on, prophetess.
I was a darn good hairstylist. Really good. Darn wasn't the word I was thinking about. But I was really good. Really good. Gifted in that thing. Could have been really good right now.
Oh, yeah.
I look at this one hairstylist, I seen her on television. Her name was Kim Kimmel. In my day, she was just getting started. Now, every entertainer that she doing, I know she doing it because I'm not there. If I was there, she wouldn't be doing it. That would be me. But I said, God, when I turn a certain age, I promise you that I'm going to live my life for you. And that age hit me. So I said, I won't stand behind a chair anymore. I'll stand behind that.
Yes, all right.
And when I made up my mind to do that, now I'm in that 7 years.
There you go.
All right.
Now it's time for the restoration.
There you go.
All right.
But I had to turn to be another man. I had to turn into another man. Meaning I had to take on another image of myself in my mind and realize the image of the one that was standing behind the chair doing the hair. She might have been laying hands on their head, but now I'm speaking to their mind. Laying hands on their head. I was literally laying hands on their mind. But now I've taken a position where I am speaking to their mind.
There you go. It makes a difference. There's a lot of people laying hands on their heads and they speak to their mind.
Another man.
Amen.
So what image you walk in? What image you walking in? What image you walking in right now? Whose report are you gonna believe? The report of the one that you see in the mirror every day, or the one that you close your eyes and you get a different view? Because when you close your eyes, you get a different view. And if you take on the image of the one that you see when your eyes are closed, literally, it's just like we said Friday night, we was doing the Women of Character. You can put this big old S on your chest. Superwoman has arrived.
Superwoman.
The apostle say, well, act like Superwoman in the house, because Lord, when something go wrong, my lip be way down there. Be like, God, wait a minute now, I'm the prophet. I'm supposed to be prophesying to the dead. He said, I'm telling you to prophesy to the dead, and I'm telling you to cast your cares on me. So if you cast your cares on me, I already care for you. Now what you gonna do for the people?
Yes, you're right.
Glory to God.
Hello, mother.
Amen.
That's the same word.
Right.
My mama.
That's right.
She said, you can't preach this word and don't live it.
You
right. She said, it came for you first. That's why you got it. It was for you. You got to get it. You got to come to the understanding. You got to know, I love you. I care for you. I called you. You didn't call yourself. Lord, have mercy for those who call themselves.
Yes, what I say. Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Have mercy on me. I have mercy on me. If you called yourself, literally called yourself to an office, God forgive you, because you have just walked yourself into hell. If you want to experience hell, pick your own office. Hey, that you are what God said. You have mercy on you.
Yourself proclaimed. Amen.
God almost had to come down here personally. Beat me down on my head, strip me from everything before I would say yes. Literally.
Lord, amen.
Lord,
but I want you to
be
a modeling.
God, in this season, God, just like Jesus was speaking to Peter, he said, who do men say that I am? So don't you know, men are always going to have a different image of you than what you really Yes. So who has literally been speaking and giving you your image? And you have come into agreement with that image. Why y'all moving my stuff? When you see me put this mic down, then you grab my stuff. Other than that, leave my stuff alone. You don't know what the hell's in the flow in. Don't be rushing me.
Go,
bro. Now, if a person was up there, they would not touch his stuff. Don't blame it on Pastor Trent. She told you to do it and you did it. Okay, you did it.
Wow.
Who is the prophet?
There you go.
See how he tried to take the field? I ain't said nothing. God is saying, he put this word in our spirit because there's a famine in the land.
Yes, it is. It's a
famine.
But you got to have a prophetic connection.
That's right.
And the famine is not getting ready to leave.
Oh, no.
2014, there was still the residues of the famine.
Yes.
2015, there will still be residues of the famine. This world will not see the famine lift until Obama is out of
office.
They will not. They will not see the famine lift until he is out of office.
That's very true.
So who do you have a prophetic connection with? Because until you realize who you connected to, you will literally be starving. Or will you be in the wrong place? Will you be in the land that he didn't tell you to be in? Or will you hear the prophet when he tells the prophet to go to the land that I have chose for you? Will you hear the prophet when the prophet give you the prophetic instructions?
It's very true.
But see, a lot of us don't get our breakthrough because we come to the prophet with an empty hand.
That's right. It's true.
That's right.
You come with an empty hand.
That's right.
You can't come to the prophet with an empty hand.
That's right.
You got to take your best gift. Because the direction that he give you is greater than the gift that you present. Because your life is on the line. Do you believe?
Yes.
Do you really believe?
Yes.
Glory to his name. Stand to your feet. Let us wake up, Ernest. I see your eyes closed back there. Wake up. Wow. Let me have some music. Let me hear that song. I'm waiting. Glory to his name.
Get that
right here. Come on. Oh, just get the oil. Give it to her.